think that that is such a temptation now, because there's have been so many people who have really jettisoned any resemblance of, you know, the biblical methodology of reaching the lost with the gospel and so on and so forth. And they are almost now into a full-on marketing scheme on how to reach the lost for Christ. And that's Ishmael to me. Yeah. I mean, that's totally the fleshly methodology that is forbidden in so many places in Scripture.
Well, I mean, it's gotten to the point now that we tend to not get too political, but I saw on the news that it mentioned that there were actually transgender people that did the prayer service. And yeah. I was like, how far have we fallen?
Yeah.
But how does this happen? How did our nation get to this point? It was because we got to the point where we basically said God is, and I hate it because they even do it if you read, sometimes when you listen to people read stories about God speaking. You know, I remember when you read and they talk about God, they get like this loud thundering voice. But now when they speak of God or they speak of Christ, it's a very soft spoken, well, God is love and he has no wrath, no fury, you know. And it's like that people have made God so soft, I guess weak. You could say.
Yeah.
And so weak, yeah. That, oh, God's, yeah. God loves everyone.
Yeah.
So it's okay to be a transgender. And
well, the inaugural prayer. I mean, yeah. Joe Biden's inaugural prayer. You know, how did the guy close the prayer? He said, in the collective name of all of our gods. I can't remember exactly yeah. how he put that, but if something.
Our faith, yeah.
Yeah, in the collective name of all of our faiths, you know, which is, you know, a very, very, that was very disappointing for me yeah. to hear yeah. somebody, you know.
It's like Zach was saying, they only showcase the good parts. Or you can say good parts of God. He's only love. We were just talking about this last night while we were up here, and I saw this article this week where this second grader, she was like 7 years old, got kicked out of a Christian school because she said she had a crush on another girl, and they kicked her out. And all the news article kept saying, or just kept, and of course, you know, it's that old, good old, our good friend CNN kept saying, well, she kept saying,
News Network.
The girl just kept saying, well, does God still love me? Does God still love me? And I'm sure they fed her some, yeah, God still loves you no matter what your choice is, but they missed the point. It's, yes, God still loves you, but he still hates your sin. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what people are forgetting. This is it. They're kicking against the pricks.
I think one of the biggest problems in the contemporary church, in the modern church, let me use that term. I think that one of the biggest problems is an entire misunderstanding of the holiness of God.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some people who misrepresent it and turn way far right, and then there's some people who misrepresent it and turn way left, and they don't. And I'm not just talking about, you know, the middle road theology. That's not what I'm into. What I am saying is that we got to let God be who God is.
Yes.
You know, and the whole outfit of the Christian, put on the whole armor of God, the belt of truth, the girdle of truth, you know, that's what cinches everything together and holds everything together. And so when we're allowing personal opinion, personal preferences, even ego to be really what sets the agenda for us, I'm finding that is unsustainable for the next generation. They're not going to understand that. They're not going to, when this big personality preacher is dead and gone, or when this big personality preacher crashes and burns, God forbid,
mm-hmm.
you know, the next generation is going to say, well, wait a minute, was that God or not? You know, and so we almost have to take our churches back to an understanding of who God truly was and is, same yesterday, today, and forever.
That's right.
So that they can get their bearings and their perspective again. Mm-hmm. That's a tall order, especially in this culture.
Yeah.
And in this day, that's a really tall order.
And it's, you know, if you have all law and no grace, you have the bondwoman that's spoken of here. But there's just as much damage as if you have all grace and no law, in a way that there is no, God's just, like I mentioned before,
absolutely.
God's just love, and you can do whatever you want. There is no law. There is no sin. In God's eyes, he loves you. You're his child. You can do no wrong. And there's just as much danger and potential bondage in that as there is in the actual law
that's
given in the Bible.
This is really crazy. I've always understood this passion since we've been talking about it, but now it's just like it's even more clear. It's people choose a side of God. They either want bad, dark side of that God, or they want the good, all loving God. Don't want the rest of him. That's crazy to me. Now this, I don't know. I just thinking about all this just made me think of that.
Well, it's making God in our image.
Yeah,
there's
that's a huge
that's
problem
it right
it
there.
Is.
Huge problem.
Yeah.
And either way, you're breaking the commandment now.
Two huge mistakes man makes is trying to do what y'all just mentioned with God, and then also trying to limit God to putting God in the box of our human understanding.
Right.
Those are the two biggest mistakes that we make.
So here's the good news. Verse 27, for it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. That's referring to Sarah. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Of course, Sarah, was barren, and she was considered cursed. She was considered and even treated obsolete by Abraham. But it turns out that the child that she bore became that promised seed that was given to Abraham, the promise, you know, that his seed would be as the sands of the seashore and the stars of heaven and so on and so forth. That began with Isaac and that development.
I love how Paul always is great with illustrations, in my opinion. He's one of the greatest. He could paint a picture in someone's mind, especially when you read it, like running the race and stuff like that. He was great about that kind of stuff. But I love how right here he turns it right back onto them. He says that, verse 29, but that he was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now.
Yep.
He flipped back on him.
Yeah.
Because... Yep. It was like, it's like some of those stories that when Jesus would tell people, be like, yeah, I agree. And you'd be like, well, if you do this, that's you. And that's what Paul did here. He's like, you know the story of Sarah and Hagar? Oh, yeah. You remember what happened? Oh, yeah. Well, if you're trying to persecute people with the law, you're that person. And they're like, oh, wait a second.
And what better man to say that than Paul?
Right.
I mean, that's exactly what he did. He knows all about the bondage life.
Pharisee of the Pharisees.
Yep. Yes. Mm-hmm. Deeply committed.
Yes.
In his lost lifetime, he was deeply committed to some of those things. So the policy there, you quoted it, Zach, in verse 29, as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. That is, again, an ancient policy. Cain, unrighteous, kills righteous Abel. We have it here. Ishmael, not the covenant son, persecuting. That's actually what caused Sarah to have them all cast out, to have he and his mother cast out, because Ishmael had turned on his younger brother Isaac. So there we have it. Then we have Jacob and Esau. We have the second birth there, and it just goes on and on and on. Those who are persuaded that the law is the answer, they in every scenario become a persecutor of the righteous. And I think that's in some case, well, exactly where we're living at today, is that there are those who want to walk by faith and not by sight. There are those who want to be subjected to the dictates of the Holy Spirit. And then there are those who are making their demands and their requirements, and they will ostracize, and they will, in many, many cases, they'll actually cut you off, you know, if you're not assimilating to the culture that they want. So that's the illustration. It really perfectly fits what he's been talking about throughout the whole book of Galatians.
And then he goes right back at those people again in verse 30. He said, nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman.
Yep. If you got to make a choice.
Mm-hmm.
If you got to make a choice.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, did he have a kid with both of them? He sure did. But when it comes down to the covenant choice, Abraham is willing with Sarah to put the bondwoman away. And by the way, you know, we don't need to leave the story unfinished here, you know, because God actually took care of Ishmael.
Yeah, he did.
He is the seed of Abraham, so that's why there's always been a lingering Arab presence, and in my estimation, that's why there always will be, is because they are the children of Abraham, and that will always be a reality that the Middle East is going to have to deal with.
True.
But he says in the closing here, verse number 30, middle of that verse, he says, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. It's an excellent illustration.
I think
it's an excellent illustration. And it goes, you know, I made a statement some years ago, and it took a little explaining for some folks to finally catch on to it. Babies are born free. They have to be taught to be slaves.
Right. Yeah.
And the nature of man-made fleshly religion is to teach bondage, to teach slavery, and to teach subjugation. And sadly, that has even crept into some evangelical churches, wherein it is needful for you to fall under the control of a certain body or the control of a certain person in the church for you to be able to function in that ministry. And that's another incredibly dangerous arrangement, I think.
Yeah, my question would be, okay, do you want to be a bondage or do you want to be free? Because if you're going to be in bondage, you're going to live like you're in bondage. You're going to be treated like you're in bondage. But if you live free, you're going to be treated like you're free. You're going to live like you're free. And I like that thought a lot better.
Now, Pastor, I got a question for you. All right, you are started teaching. By the way, you could actually, I'll go ahead and plug this in here. We have a college here. If you want to listen to it online, it is TT Institute, correct?
TTInstitute.org.
TTInstitute.org. You can listen to it there, but you actually just started one on church conflict resolution. Right. And I just have a question for you. A lot of the conflicts, because it does talk here about someone being persecuted, do you think that that could also be related to the people that are the quote-unquote bondwoman, or the people that self-enslave themselves are the ones that are causing a lot of problems in the church?
Yeah, I think there's no doubt that there's a connection there. There's no doubt, because the religion, and I use that term, I'm not a fan of that term.
Right.
Religion, evangelicalism, if you want to add that term, it's a light that tends to draw the bugs. And there's a lot of room and a lot of latitude for people to come in and try to take control. You can even see that in a typical typical service or an event at the church. You know, sometimes a visitor may come staggering in there and they feel like somebody, and they may even try to insinuate that they want to take control of a service or something of that nature. And so it is man's ambition. I think naturally most men have a built-in determination sort of to be in control of things, and that is very, very dangerous when it comes to controlling another brother in Christ. Mm. Their liberty. That's why Paul earlier, I think it was chapter 2, he said, stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free. We do not have to submit to that kind of bondage. And that's why he withstood Peter to the face, because I think Peter was overreaching. I think he was overreaching when he was suggesting that people should be circumcised. Mm-hmm. Too much there.
Yeah, I was curious about that because the word persecuted.
That's chapter 5, I should say. Chapter 5, verse 1.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
One other thought here, too, in this passage, I think it's just an interesting one, but there, verse 26, Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. And then, of course, the imperative thought that Paul shares in Philippians 3:20, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
That's good.
And I just think that's a exciting thought of looking forward to the future. And, you know, you think of the new Jerusalem and
can't wait for that.
Holy city coming down.
That's got to be it, right? That's got to be the reference there.
I think, again, it's a encouragement and a motivation to us today who are true believers to know what awaits us. And
absolutely.
To look to that in the future and just realize, wait a minute, every single promise God has made, he's fulfilling. I mean, there's nothing
that's exactly
that
right.
He has ever said that he is not going to fulfill.
That's right.
Yeah. And,
it's just an awesome thought.
Yes,
yeah.
It is.
In chapter
it's a good
5,
balance, isn't it?
Chapter 5, to look ahead, it gets into a lot of it starts talking about the works of the flesh, you know, fruits of the spirit, all that stuff. So excited for what's coming, for sure, in Galatians. So, but definitely a meaty passage that we've been caught in. But thank you guys. Thank you, Brother Calvert, for joining in with us.
Yes. It was good to have you.
Please come back.
Happy to be here.
He needs to come back. So whenever he wants to come back, we'd love to have him. If he decides never to come back, we may slash his tires. But he'll figure that out one day when he's trying to drive away from the church. So we'll figure it out. Thank you guys, though, seriously, for joining in. I hope you guys enjoyed it. As a reminder, you can catch us on our church's website, which is www.brandonbaptisttabernacle.com. There you have hundreds of archives, like we mentioned, Throwing Out the Hag. You can find all these messages online. There are a lot of great ones.
You're never going to live that down.
Personally, I do like all of Pastor's messages, but I really did enjoy the one on the shepherd, spending time with the shepherd. I did enjoy that, so I would encourage you to go listen to that. It is on the church's website now, I believe. You can also look on our church's Facebook. We post some different resources there. It's just the name of the church, Brandon Baptist Tabernacle. You can go to our YouTube page. You can listen to the podcast there. As mentioned before, we are having some more podcasts coming out, so we're excited about that, getting more content out there. But we are also on Google, Spotify, iTunes. Like I said before, if you could do me a favor and just leave us a comment, like it, subscribe, share it with people around you, we would really enjoy that. So thank you guys for tuning in to another episode of Cherishing Scripture Podcast, a podcast where we're changing society by cherishing Scripture.